In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The text for our Reformation meditation this morning is recorded in the Revelation of Jesus Christ to St. John, the 14th chapter, reading verses 6 and 7. Then I saw another angel flying in midair, and he had the eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on the earth, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. He said in a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water." This is God's word. Fellow redeemed in Christ Jesus, heirs of the everlasting gospel, redeemed in the work of the Lutheran Reformation. Some people have the mistaken idea that we Lutherans worship Dr. Martin Luther. Nothing could be further from the truth. Oh, it is true that we hold the good doctor in high regard. We thank God for Luther and for no small number of German princes who supported him in their love for God's word and their esteeming that word of God above all else, even their own lives. What God accomplished through the gospel, through the personal qualities and joint efforts of Martin Luther and the other reformers and these princes, is not something that we should take lightly. Really, we could put it in parallel to young King Josiah. Remember? The word of the Lord had gotten shoved aside and become buried by the kings of the southern kingdom of Judah, and they followed idols. And one day, Josiah found the word of the Lord in the temple, and he brought it out, dusted it off, and commanded that it should be read in front of all the people. In the centuries prior to 1500, the dark cloud of human counsel and human tradition had settled upon the church like a big, thick, black cloud. And the gospel of salvation alone through faith in Jesus Christ had become buried under those traditions, under those laws and regulations of men. The head of the Christian church exalted himself above all that is God, and above all the Bible's teaching of the forgiveness of all of our sins solely through the sacrificial life and death of our Savior Jesus Christ. But God would not allow the gates of hell to prevail against his church and to destroy it. And so God called in the fulfillment of this revelation an angel, a messenger, and he had the eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on earth, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. As heirs of the salvation of Jesus Christ and heirs of the Lutheran Reformation, we very properly apply these words in the revelation of Christ to St. John, to Martin Luther. To Luther, called by God to restore the gospel. You see, first of all, that Luther was called by God for this work of the Reformation. And secondly, that in that work, Luther taught nothing else except that everlasting gospel. Martin Luther was 33 years old on October 31st, 1517. What gave him the right, the authority, to nail 95 theses or statements challenging the church to a debate on the sale of indulgences? Indulgences were a piece of paper that you could purchase for yourself or someone who was already dead that would remove the stain of the sin that was left behind after Christ's sacrifice and would buy your way or your loved one's way of many years out of the so-called state of purgatory. But what gave him the authority and the right to do that? The church did. The church called Luther to be a monk, and then to be a priest. Then the church made Luther a doctor of theology. And then the church established Luther in a professorship at Wittenberg. So the church really put Martin Luther in the position and the place to study the scriptures. And when Luther did that, he discovered there's a lot that my church is teaching that isn't in the Bible. There's a lot of things that my church is practicing that really go contrary to being saved by grace alone, through faith alone, revealed in the scripture alone. Sure. The church had called Martin Luther to give his allegiance to the papacy and to his church, but the church also gave Luther the authority to study and teach God's word. And it was that study of God's word that began the Lutheran Reformation. Luther was a smart man. Whenever the church got after him, Luther would appeal to his call. He'd say, well, you made me a priest. You made me a professor. You told me when you made me a professor, quote, we give you authority to teach the word of God, unquote. Luther said, that's exactly what I'm doing. And in my search of the scripture and in teaching that word, I have found that this idea that you can buy the forgiveness of your sins, even for somebody who is already dead, to be a terrible doctrine of men. Or to teach that you're saved by doing penance, or by making pilgrimages, or by doing good works, that you can earn the forgiveness of your sins. There is nothing in the scripture that talks anything about that. The preacher and the professor, the priest, had vowed in his call to study and teach God's word. And that's exactly what he did, no matter how much trouble it got him into. He pointed out those errors on the basis of God's word. The point of this is, Luther didn't start the Lutheran Reformation like some snoop who went around on his own and just decided, I'm going to reform the church because I don't like what's going on. Luther wasn't some peasant that wandered in off the street and said, I know more than the church. I know more than those great learned men who have established in the councils and the traditions the doctrines and practices that are driving men into despair and giving them false hope for themselves and for their relatives. Luther acted under his rightful call from the church to do exactly what he did. They had appointed Luther to his offices, and Luther took their command to heart. He did exactly what they told him to do. Authority, though, is something different than ability. Just because you give somebody the authority to do something doesn't mean that they have the ability to do it. Luther had also the ability to study and teach God's word, but that ability didn't come from the church. That ability didn't come from the call that men extended to him for those offices. Luther's ability came from God. Like David, the shepherd boy, God called this servant of his church not only for the man that he already was, but God called him for the man that God would make him to accomplish the purposes for which he had called him. Luther had certain natural and native gifts for the Reformation. God knew that. God had created him with those gifts, as he creates us all with various gifts. But then when God called Luther to this work of the Reformation, God nurtured those gifts, enabled Luther to develop those gifts and to use those gifts, not for self-aggrandizement, not to just be a troublemaker, but to really preach and teach and live God's holy word. And so, like God called David to lead his people, so God called Martin Luther to do the same. First and foremost, Martin Luther had a deep and real sense of his own corruption. Luther couldn't look at a picture of Jesus without being terrified. Luther beat himself, slept on the concrete floor, starved himself, used his body in many other ways, which led to a lot of health issues, most likely later in life. But he just could not find any peace with God. He had a deep and real sense of his own sin and corruption and fear of falling into the hands of the living God and going to hell. But then, when God, through this Luther's study of the Word, showed Luther that the righteousness of Christ is not law, but gospel, Luther said it was like the gates of paradise were thrown wide open for me. Luther came to realize that the righteousness of God is the righteousness of Christ under the law that covers over his and all of our sins. And that gave him the peace and the hope and the joy that he now wanted to share with his own people and with others. But God had also given Martin Luther other gifts that enabled him to do the work and propel the work of the Lutheran Reformation. Martin Luther had an eloquent knowledge of the original languages of the Scripture. Luther had an eloquent knowledge of the German language, and he was able to translate the Bible into German, to really give them one German language where they could read and know their Savior by reading the Bible and seeing it from the Bible. Luther had a heroic faith that stood on the Holy Scripture alone. He never wanted credit for himself. He never wanted men to model their faith after his, but rather in their faith to hold on to Christ alone, to hold on to the Scripture and God's grace also alone. He had that heroic faith, as we heard about in our gospel lesson this morning, as he stood before the church and the emperor, before the councils and the government, and said that I'm going to take my stand on God's word. I'm not going to take a stand on anything else. That I'm not going to give up what I said or wrote just to save my life. Luther once said, quote, if I had 100 heads, I would gladly lose them all for the word of God. Unquote. God gave to Martin Luther that heroic faith. God gave to Luther those things that he spoke before those councils and those diets. And finally, Luther had a spirit of self-denial to do what he needed to do, to spend the hours and the time and the effort, to not be afraid, but to work constantly for the sake of the Reformation. And he was able to do that because he trusted in God to take care of him. One of the great and often missed things about Martin Luther is he died dead. That he died an old man of illness. Because once he was excommunicated, there was a price on his head, and there were no few people that wanted and would have loved to see him dead. But it was a miracle of God's grace that protected him, because God wanted him to do the work of the Reformation. To do those things that you and I still enjoy as Orthodox Christians, as Orthodox and historic Lutherans, in a day when more and more Lutherans travel under that name, but really do not teach much of what Lutheranism, or even sadly in some cases, Orthodox Christianity really means. God stood at Luther's side, even as his enemies saw his life. And he never was afraid. He never worried about what was going to happen to him, because he knew that God would take care of him. It was with that deep sense of God's call and God's purpose that Martin Luther fulfilled that prophecy to be that angel and that messenger. Now, we don't want to get too important here and think that St. John was, or that Christ was thinking only of Martin Luther when he gave that prophecy to John, because that's certainly not the case. But we may apply it to Luther, because it's true of him. His only work that he did, he taught nothing else than the everlasting gospel. John saw in that revelation that Jesus, the risen and exalted Christ, gave to him the New Testament era, when the truth of God's word would expose the anti-Christian and un-Christian teachings that would come up in the church, where the gospel of Jesus Christ would expose those who place themselves in the church above God and claim that their word is equal to God or above God's word. That gospel exposes false doctrine and the evil practices of men. Luther's message was this: fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the seas, and the springs of water. You and I are living in that age of the last days, when the judgment of God comes against those who teach error, as it is exposed by the true gospel of Christ. But don't ever forget, it isn't rumor, it isn't the Lutheran church that exposes falsehood. It's the Word of God that does that. It's the Holy Spirit that does that through the Holy Scriptures. It is the Bible, the eternal gospel, that God's angels, God's messengers, who are faithful to that word today, take out into the world. The Bible is our source of truth and life. God's word is our great heritage as Orthodox Lutheran Christians. Luther's Reformation was a Bible Reformation. Luther's Christianity was a Bible Christianity. The church that Luther intended for is a Bible church. From that word, in the church today, thanks to the Lutheran Reformation, the truth that we are saved by grace alone, by faith alone, continues to pour out in torrents upon the peoples of this world. Our church body is part of what's called the Confessional Evangelical Lutheran Conference, which is a group of 29 Orthodox Lutheran churches around the world from nearly every continent on the planet. And we all join together and confess those same truths that God allowed Martin Luther and the other reformers to preach and to teach. No, we do not worship Dr. Martin Luther. believe that we're the only ones going to heaven. We don't believe that. We don't teach that. But we do believe and teach, and all of you confess that by belonging to this church, that you believe the same thing. That what we have is that heritage of the Scripture from the Lutheran Reformation. We don't worship Luther, but it certainly would be a terrible contradiction if we said, God, thank you for calling Martin Luther to do what he did, but now we're going to turn away from that. It's not popular. People don't like it. We don't grow and we stick to it. So we're going to give it all up so that we can follow our own reason and our own desires and our own wants. Orthodoxy and heresy are not, like many people think, the result of different people who love the Bible having different interpretations. Orthodoxy comes to people who love God's Word and listen to that Word and let it speak to them. Heresy and false doctrine comes by those who reject God's Word, who turn away from God's Word and say, no, we'll follow our own reason. We'll follow our own understanding and our own desires. Your friends in Christ, fellow Lutherans, be faithful. Continue in the old, approved, trustworthy truth of God for the welfare and salvation of your eternal souls. Be steadfast and immovable on Jesus Christ and in God's Word until death. Never worship Martin Luther. Never worship any human being or any pastor who preaches God's Word. But at the same time, with those who speak the truth, and with Martin and in regard to Martin Luther, remember Hebrews 13, verse 7. Remember your leaders who spoke the Word of God to you. Consider their way of life and imitate their faith. Amen.